Welcome to Destined Win TV. Thank you for joining us. Once again, I want to encourage you to join us at Family Church Bryant on your app store and get our app. It's absolutely free. It has all of our outlines, videos, even a place to give. And we would love to have you drop by Family Church in Bryant. A church alive is worth the drive. We're located right here on Interstate 30 between Bryant and Benton. And I'm telling you, we would be honored to have you join us and worship our resurrected Jesus. Also, in this program, we're talking about unusual miracles. And as we talked about in our previous show, if there are special or unusual miracles, does that indicate that there are usual miracles? Really never thought about miracles just being ordinary or usual, but it says that the Apostle Paul, God used him, Acts 19:11, and God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul. The New King James says God worked unusual miracles. Another word that's used in the original text is extraordinary miracles. So if there's extraordinary miracles, must mean there's ordinary ones. If there's unusual miracles, it means there must be usual miracles. And if there are special miracles, maybe there's just regular miracles. So I am believing God with you right now for God to do a usual, ordinary, regular kind of miracle in your life. What are you believing God for? The Bible says if two of us agree as touching anything in heaven, it shall be done. So I come into agreement right now with the promises of God and with you for the healing power of God to flow powerfully right there where you are. I believe God's touching you, touching your heart, and healing your body, forgives all of our iniquities and heals all of our diseases. So I celebrate God's healing power as we look at unusual miracles. So let's look here in verse number 12 of Acts 19 as we're studying the book of Acts verse by verse. So that from Paul's body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs and aprons, and these diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. I believe the presence of God is personal and it is tangible. If you think about when they buried the prophet, the power of God still rested on him so strongly that when they threw men in on top of him, they rose from the dead. Wow. Don't we need that kind of Holy Ghost power? Don't we need that kind of God in our daily living in this current generation? I say yes and amen. Now, verse number 13, interesting things start transpiring. It says, then certain Jews, vagabond Jews and exorcists, took upon themselves to call over them which had evil spirits the name of the Lord Jesus. This is really kind of funny. It's kind of sad in a way. They had a formula. They probably had heard about the disciples or the apostles being used of God, like Philip in Samaria, like the apostle Paul in Ephesus. Paul even used being the anointing on his handkerchiefs and aprons being laid upon people, them getting healed and delivered of evil spirits. So they decided, hey, we've got a formula too. We'll just go out and cast out devils in the name of Jesus. And it says, they went out about saying, we adjure you by the name of Jesus whom Paul preaches. And there were about seven sons of one Sceva, a Jew, a chief of the priests, which did this. And listen to this. And the evil spirit answered. You know, Jesus said in John 10, my sheep hear my voice. Did you know the Holy Spirit can speak? That's why we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. In the previous show, we talked about what the Holy Spirit does when He comes into our life. And I encourage you to get our app and you can go back and watch that show. You can go to our website and see it as well, I believe. But did you notice here the evil spirit answered? Remember when Jesus arrived on shore and the guy in the Gadarenes was possessed of the devil and the spirit spake and said, have you come to torment us before our time? Do you know the devil knows his time's coming? That's why we're living in perilous times, because all hell is breaking loose because the devil is fighting for his eternity. And I've read the end of the book, we win. I've read the middle of the book, we've already won. So the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus, I know. Oh, my goodness. The Bible says in James, the devil believes and trembles. He doesn't believe unto salvation, but he knows who Jesus is. Now listen to the next part. And Paul, I know. Is your name known in the pits of hell? Is your name known in the midst of dominion authorities? Is your name a name that is known to glorify the risen Jesus, Savior of mankind? It says, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but listen to this, but who are you? Have you ever said that to somebody? Well, who do you think you are? Who are you? That's what the devil looks at these seven pranksters, these counterfeiters, and he says, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you? So there are always counterfeiters. Now, there's no counterfeit if there's not the genuine. Now, just as an illustration, have you ever been to the store and you go, remember, y'all still use money? And you go to the store and you hand them behind the counter your bill and they do like this. And they look at you, they look at your money. Or they take that pen and they mark the pen. You're looking at them like, do I look like a counterfeiter? They're not questioning you. They're verifying the genuine. So don't take it personal. Really, people aren't questioning you. They're questioning whether or not what you say you got is real. So there's always going to be counterfeiters. Be genuine, not fake. Somebody told me this about 12 years ago. Yeah, the church I went to, the preacher always said, you got to fake it till you make it. Are you kidding me? You don't have to fake it when you're genuine. Be the real deal. People may be looking at you, but you know what they're doing? They're looking to see if you're real. And I'm going to tell you, when you're real, when you're genuine, when you're transparent, don't expect everybody to like you. The reality is simple. There are going to be times when you being transparent is offensive because we've become so accustomed to being fake. Don't be fake. Be the real deal. And it says, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you? And the man in whom the evil spirit was in leaped on them, overcame them, and prevailed against them so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded. Don't be a streaker. Be the real deal. We're going to be right back. Have you ever considered a Christian education for your child? Then you should check out Arkansas Christian Academy, Saline County's fully accredited premier Christian school at an affordable family rate. Students have opportunities to excel in academics, athletics, fine arts, and technology. And through our dual enrollment program, high school students can even achieve an associate's degree prior to graduation. Visit us at arkansaschristianacademy.org. Hi, I'm Pastor Perry Black right here at Arkansas Christian Academy. And on this set is one of our seniors, Harrison Kanai. Harrison, good to have you. How long have you been going to ACA?
7 years.
7 years, yes, and you're a high school senior. What are you going to do when you graduate?
I'm going to tradesman school in Tennessee. I'm going to be a lineman working on like electrical poles and stuff like that.
And why did you pick that career?
Because I like working with my hands, and yeah. I like to do outside work, so I feel like that'd be a really fun job to do.
And here at ACA, you played football, basketball, probably made straight A's?
A's and B's.
A's and B's, yeah. And what do you specifically like about ACA?
I like kind of the sports section where it's really small. Everybody kind of, you know, it's like a family. So I felt very connected to everybody that I know.
Connected with your peers?
Yes, sir.
What about your educators? What were they like? What was the environment like
here at ACA? It was really awesome to have like one-on-one time. Like if I had a question, I knew I could just go to my teachers and just ask them, you know, I'm really struggling in this, so I just really need you to help me right here. And they say, well, you know, come during this class period and, you know, we can help.
So you got support,
yes,
spiritually and educationally.
Yes, most definitely.
And if you had to do over again, you think it was a wise investment for your mom and dad?
I think it was. Good. I think it really was.
Why don't you consider ACA. God bless. Welcome back. In our previous segment, we talked about being the real deal. You know, people are looking for genuine Christianity, and we don't have to fake it till we make it. I'm telling you, when you live with transparency before God and man, I believe you'll also live in favor with both God and man. So in verse number 16 of Acts chapter 19, the Apostle Paul, who God is using in a powerful way, they're taking handkerchiefs and aprons and laying it on sick people, are getting healed, laying on people possessed with the devil, they're getting delivered. And so seven sons of Sceva decide they're gonna imitate Paul. Scripture says in Ephesians, be ye imitators of God. You know, we don't need to imitate our favorite preacher. We don't need to imitate our best friend. What we need to do is be like Jesus. And that's what Paul is doing. And these seven sons of Sceva said, in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches. Listen, when you don't have a personal, intimate relationship with God through Jesus Christ, you're going to have to fake it. But when you have Jesus in you, the creator of the universe, the one who lived and died and rose again, you don't have to fake it. Just be real. That means even though we are human and though we may have human frailties, we don't have to fake it. We just don't have to. But there's always going to be those who try to imitate or counterfeit the real deal, sometimes for personal gain. But it says, the evil spirit looked at him, and the evil spirit spoke through this man. And he said, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you? And the man in whom the evil spirit lived leaped on them and overcame them, and they fled out of the house naked and wounded. Now look at verse 17. And this was known to all the Jews and Greeks dwelling in Ephesus, and fear or reverence fell on them all. And what happened? The name of the Lord was magnified. When imitators are exposed, revival breaks out. When imitators are exposed, revival breaks out. I don't believe anybody's impressed with trickery or fakeness. I believe people are impressed when we, with all of our flaws, live to glorify God and allow God to flow through us to hurting humanity. And many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds. Now here these guys are faking it. They get exposed. They actually get exposed by the devil himself. And that's fascinating. And as a result, the name of the Lord is magnified, and many believed, came and confessed and showed their deeds. Many of them also used curious arts, brought their books together and burned them before all men, and they counted the price of them and found it to be 50,000 pieces of silver. Do the math on that. That's a lot of silver. And mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. Do you see what's happening here? Genuine faith is preceded by repentance. Genuine faith is preceded by repentance and demonstrated by new life. These folks, when the holy reverence of God came upon them, supernatural transformation started taking place. They brought their evil works. You know, James chapter 5 says that we should confess our faults one to another. That's what they're actually doing. They brought all of their evil deeds and laid them before all men. What they did is they cast their sins before the Lord. And God takes our sins and casts them into the sea of forgetfulness. Genuine faith is always preceded by repentance. And what is repentance? Going one direction, having a change of heart, a change of mind, and a change of direction. That's repentance. Demonstrated now by this new life. And it says, as a result, mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. You notice when they put into action what they believed and what they had received, you know what happened? It changed their life, and all of a sudden the power of God and the word of God is flowing powerfully to them and now through them. Mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. That means it overcame. Now, verse 17, Acts 19. And this was known to all the Jews and the Greeks dwelling in Ephesus. Fear fell upon them. The word of God was proclaimed and confirmed and resulted in salvation for the lost. Did you see that? When the word of God is proclaimed and confirmed with signs following, it will result in salvation for the lost, and it will always magnify Jesus. I remember I was flying many years ago to Conroe, Texas, near Houston, and the Lord began to minister to me a message about burnout. And I thought, well, I've never been burnt out, unless maybe I was so burnt out I didn't know I was burnt out. And so that weekend, I preached a message on burnout. Did you realize, as a result of that message, and I didn't think it was one of the best messages ever preached by any stretch of the imagination, seven people were born again when I taught on burnout. As a result, two couples, that's four people, were born again, husband and wife, born again. That changed their family dynamic, as well as three other individuals. They all came to the altar, gave their life to Jesus Christ, and all I was doing was proclaiming the Word of God. God confirmed it with salvations, and as a result of God confirming His Word with salvations, Jesus was magnified. And it says, and many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds. Repentance is a missing ingredient in the life of too many who call themselves Christians. There's actually a teaching that has migrated through the body of Christ. Well, you know, once you give your life to Jesus, you never, ever need to repent again. You just don't need to. You know, everything, past, present, and future, is under the blood. Well, there's an element of truth in that, but let me remind you, Dr. Edwin Coe said it many years ago, a half-truth is a whole lie. I live in a lifetime of perpetual repentance. What does that mean? That means, like in Hebrews chapter 12, any weights or sins that are holding me back, I pray Holy Spirit will reveal that to me, show that to me, and that I would be humble enough to acknowledge what He shows me, and I would repent by throwing off every weight and sin. And you know, sometimes there are sins in our life, and sometimes there's just things that are holding us down, weighting us down. What's holding you back? What's holding you down? Repentance lays aside every weight. Ephesians says, throw off the old man. We'll be right back. Hey everybody, Perry Black here, along with Rachel Hubbard from Second Chance Youth Ranch. And Rachel, we've got a big event coming up, our annual fundraiser. Can you give us some information about that?
October the 13th, 7 o'clock at the Benton Event Center, we're having our annual fundraiser. Goal is to raise $250,000 to open a new home. Socially distanced, very careful, following all the guidelines, but we'd love for you to join us.
Hey Rachel, I want to sponsor a table. What does that mean?
All you have to do is send us a donation. You can contact us through the website.
So table sponsors about $1,000.
About $1,000 each.
And then I invite my friends to come and be exposed to the ministry of Second Chance Youth Ranch on how we can change the world one heart and one life at a time through fostering, mentoring, and adoption.
Yes, sir.
Isn't that a great opportunity? So why don't you just tell people right now how they can reach us?
So reach us by going to our website, 2cyr.org, and click Contact Us.
We look forward to hearing from you. I pray you're enjoying these Bible studies as we're going belaboriously right through the book of Acts, chapter 19. We want to reiterate a few points. Number one, there are always counterfeiters. So let me just say this. No matter how many preachers have disappointed you, no matter how many Christians have disappointed you, press on, keep the faith. There's always going to be counterfeiters. And there can only be a counterfeiter if there's something real that they're pretending to be. So you hang in there. You be the real deal. Christianity is not a list of rules and religious formulas. The sons of Sceva found out there aren't any religious formulas. It's about a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, the Lord of heaven and earth. And when the Word of God is proclaimed, it will always result with people making the decision to be saved or to reject the truth. The Scripture says that they refused to love the truth. And as the Lord and His Word is being preached, we begin to receive revelation knowledge when we mix it with faith. And listen to this. The enemy, point number two, the enemy will flee from the believer who knows their authority in Jesus Christ. James chapter 4, verse 7, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. One translation says, he will flee from you in terror. In other words, sometimes you gotta put your foot down and just say, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke you, I command you to leave. And he will leave for a more opportune time. But we don't just resist the devil, we draw near to God. And then as we draw near to God, he draws near to us. I say it like this, God instituted the covenant, but we instigate the promises working effectively in our life. The enemy will flee from the believer who knows their authority in Jesus. In Luke chapter 10, verse 19, it says, behold, Jesus speaking, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions. He's not talking about physical serpents and scorpions. He's talking about principalities, powers, and rulers of darkness. And over all the power of the enemy. Should I read that to you again? Over all the power of the enemy. And nothing by any means shall hurt you. Now you look at the Apostle Paul's testimony. He was beaten repeatedly. He was stoned. He was shipwrecked. He was in the ocean overnight more than one time. He was attacked by his Jewish brethren. He was attacked by bandits and thieves. And yet he declared that through all the fiery trials, God was always faithful. Jesus speaking, he said, nothing shall by any means harm you. Psalms 91 says he gives angels charge over us. That means we have divine protection. Just recently in church and in our study, you'll find Paul was on the island, shipwrecked, a snake latches on. Paul just looks at it, shakes it off in the fire. Nothing by any means shall hurt you. We've been given power over the enemy. That means we have no reason to fear because we are people of faith. Faith with corresponding action. Faith that moves the hand of God in unusual, extraordinary, miraculous ways. In verse number 18, and many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds. True repentance is evidenced by our actions. Did you get that? True faith produces corresponding action, creating the atmosphere for a healthy relationship with Jesus. Oh, we can fake other people out. We can fool some people some of the time. We can't fool all the people all the time. And we can never fool God any of the time. True repentance is evidenced by actions creating an atmosphere for a healthy relationship with Jesus. Many of those brought their books. They burned them. That word grew mightily and prevailed. We covered that in the previous segment, but now listen to this statement. Too many churches are filled with carnal believers. Sometimes we preachers get our focus off of getting the people filled and trying to get the chairs or the pews filled. We need to be focused on getting people full of the Word of God and full of the Spirit of God, walking full of the love of God, which makes our faith work. Galatians 5, 6. Too many churches are filled with carnal, fleshly-led believers, laden down with their old habits and lifestyles, who aren't willing to accept their true deliverance. You know, I don't believe there's anything more frustrating than being a Christian, being controlled by the old nature who is dead. Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. Romans 6:12 says this, let not sin therefore rule or reign in your mortal bodies that you should obey its lust thereof, neither yield or present your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin. Why? Because the end of sin is death, James chapter 1. But yield yourselves or present yourselves. Instead of yielding, you know, and driving, you yield. That's passive. This word in the original text literally means present yourselves as unto God, as those that are alive from the dead, as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness. That reminds me of Romans chapter 12. Be no longer conformed to the world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. It says that we now prove what is acceptable unto God. This is our holy and reasonable service, to present your bodies a living sacrifice. We take our old man, bury him or her in water baptism, we share in his resurrected life, and then we give our new life, our temple of the Holy Ghost, as instruments of righteousness unto God. Look at verse 14, Romans 6. For sin shall not have dominion over you, because you're no longer under law, you're under grace. That means that drug addiction is broken right now in Jesus' name. That alcoholic tendency that runs in your family, that generational curse, is broken by the grace that's found in the name and the blood of Jesus Christ. You are more than a conqueror in Him. Romans 8, verse 1 says this, there is therefore now. Well, where is now? That's where faith is. Faith is now. Now faith is the title deed. It's the evidence, the title of things not seen and things that we are hoping for in our future. There is therefore now no condemnation of those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. My challenge to you, do you know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior? Have you allowed Jesus to baptize you in the Holy Ghost and fire? Ask and you shall receive. God bless you. We'll see you again right here at Destined TV next time. Bye-bye. 2 Timothy chapter 2, I believe it is, says that the servant of the Lord must not strive but be gentle and apt to teach, that God preadventure would grant people repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, that they might save themselves from the snare of the devil. What does that mean? You just keep loving people, keep teaching the Word of God, and you know what God will do? He'll open people's hearts, and what was just absolutely stupid and asinine and just ridiculous a moment ago, boom! Jesus come into your heart like He did me.